Greetings from the Chennai Center for China Studies. It's good to meet you all back again with the topic Remembering Tiananmen Square. When forgetting is compulsory, remembering can be a lonely business. 32 years ago, on 4th of June 1989, Tiananmen Square became the focus for large-scale protests, which were crushed brutally by the Chinese communist rulers. The events produced one of the most iconic photos of the 20th century, a lone protester standing in front of a line of army tanks. Remembering the events of 4th June 1989 has never been allowed in the People's Republic of China, where it has been officially censored. Each year, around this time, the censorship increases. Sensitive words, numbers, photographs, symbols, including emojis, anything that could be a reference to the event, disappear online. Activists are sent on enforced holidays, online events are shut down, and security tightens around the Beijing Square. Today, the Chennai Center for China Studies attempts to remember the student-led demonstrations that call for democracy, free speech, and a free press in China, which were brutally crushed by the military. Because we believe this also holds pertinence and relevance today due to China's actions in the geopolitical arena. On this note, I request Commodore R.S. Vasan, Indian Navy retired, Director, Chennai Center for China Studies, and Regional Director, National Maritime Foundation, to deliver a note on remembering Tiananmen Square. This will be followed by a brief question and answer. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Bala. On the 32nd anniversary, of course, first of all, on behalf of all of us here, I'd like to pay homage to the souls, you know, who are there trying to bring in freedom of speech as values of liberal democracies. But as correctly brought out by Bala, what stands out is that lone person who was thereafter called the tank man, who stood in front of the line of tanks protesting against the atrocities of the Communist Party in China. Even today, you know, routinely till the national laws were passed in Hong Kong, every year there used to be a commemoration, or rather not commemoration as such, but more a remembrance of this event which was being conducted at Hong Kong, in many places. This was curbed last year, and this year they have become even more stringent, and they have ensured that, you know, there is no gathering of any sort in various places which are there in Hong Kong. So this evening, reports have clearly said that the police have been deployed in large number. In some cases, up to 7,000 policemen have been deployed in Hong Kong to see that nobody talks about Tiananmen Square. 32 years down the line, when you look at the series of events that have happened, China, the Communist Party, has been consistent in repressing the aspirations of the people, be it in Xinjiang, be it in Taiwan, be it in Hong Kong. Wherever they are there, they would like to ensure that they rule with an iron hand. And there is no concept of liberal democracies and freedom of speech, which is understood, but the way they come down heavily, using brutal force to suppress these kind of expressions, is something that's worrisome for the rest of the world. In the last couple of days, we have all noticed that Chinese president suddenly is now looking at sending a message that will make others love China. I'm not sure, you know, how these people will start loving China, except for the money that they give to developing countries. So it's important to remember that, you know, some of the pictures that are there in the gallery, there's a beautiful gallery that's available, which we had used when we marked the occasion on the 30th anniversary in Chennai Center for China Studies. And that tells you what happened on that day. We also had a book release recently, a discussion of Ambassador Vijay Gokhale, who was a youngster who was spending his time in Beijing and who had first-hand access to the information in the melee that was happening all around him. And that book was discussed here. So So there are many unanswered questions as far as how the events unfolded and how it came to a close. Of course, the brutal force was one reason, primary reason, and the determination of the Communist Party to say that we will put this down come what may. So in the book that we discussed here with Ambassador Gokhale, a lot of things came out about the cultural dimensions, about the aspirations of China at that time as a power that would like to replace USA, etc. These are all in the making. Now, you look at some of the photographs in 89 and start looking at some of those photographs in Tiananmen Square today, and you realize that a phenomenal amount of transformation has taken place in terms of the surveillance capability, which can dip in the bud any kind of trouble that's likely to foment, whether it's in Hong Kong, whether it's in Tiananmen Square, whether it's in Taiwan, whether it's in Xinjiang. So here is a police state that will go all out to suppress it. And this is our for the rest of the world to stand united, to say that we support these voices in China behind the bamboo curtain. And we are in solidarity with the millions of voices which lay suppressed today in various regions in China. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I have a few questions for you. I'd be grateful if you could take up. The Tiananmen Square of the 1989, which is also commonly known as the June 4th incident, to you, especially for democracies today, what does it mean today?
I know it's very simple that, you know, there is a different system of governance out there and they have made people accept it. You know, unlike in liberal democracies where people can take to the streets, even that option is not available. Also, the fact that there is total control using technology regimes and artificial intelligence, including on social media tabs, it becomes extremely difficult for people to express dissent. They can't even voice their opinion. So how they find their voice is by being in democracies, whether it's in USA or in India or in Japan or Australia. It's from these places that some of these voices raise to the surface and tell us firsthand as to what is happening in China. So we do not see a great change in terms of how they will deal with their people. Like I said, whether it's in Xinjiang, whether it's in Hong Kong, whether it is in any of these places which are there. So this will be the path, that before such any important event, they will have enough surveillance and ensure that they are not allowed even to express their dissent. The people in China are also ingenious. In many of the cases, even when they know that the social media websites and others are stopping their mention of the Tiananmen Square, they find many other ways of discussing it in the WeChat and Weibo. But that is not enough.
Thank you, sir. The shocks of Tiananmen of 1989, they still continue to haunt the People's Republic of China as well as the Communist Party of China. And they have done everything to suppress the memory of what happened. In your view, despite being China claiming to be a great power, do you think China is still an insecure power?
Doubtlessly so, particularly the recent statements after the COVID, where more and more countries are coming out in the open against the autocratic ways of China, and also the way they deal with their neighbors and even small countries is something that shows China in poor light. Here is a clear example where we saw a small country, Palau, you know, which is just got a population of some 21,000 or whatever, which would be less than in one of the busiest streets of Beijing, standing up to China and saying that you take the walk. And they've even requested America to come and position their forces there. And this was in reference to when China wanted Palau to break their relations with Taiwan. So, you know, here is a country which is an aspirational power, but is very unsure of itself, because everywhere it seems to be facing resistance, whether it is in Bangladesh, whether it's in Palau, whether it's in Australia, which has one of a prominent trade partner, whether it's in India, whether it's in USA. So I'm sure the party leaders must be looking at what has gone wrong. What have we gone wrong? So some of the results are today visible in terms of Xi reaching out and saying that let's send out the char positive Chinese message. So obviously, it's very right to ask this question as to is China feeling very insecure today? Yes, it feels insecure, all because of its own doing. And you know, you reap what you sow.
Thank you, sir. Before we conclude, I have a final question for you. It's been 32 years since the Tiananmen Square massacre happened, but the Chinese government has yet to acknowledge and claim responsibility for the killing of hundreds of civilians on the bloody incident on June 4, 1989. Indeed, the authorities have not only stubbornly refused to assess what they describe as a counter-revolutionary rebellion, they have persisted in their efforts to erase the public memory of these events. How do you see this, sir?
Well, you know, there is nothing unusual about this. This is how they have suppressed it. In fact, all the results of, you know, whether it is the leap, great leap forward, or the Cultural Revolution, or the Tiananmen Square, there are thousands of people who have died, you know, because of the party's determination to put anything down. So this has been the pattern. However, they cannot stop, you know, reporting of these events from outside the world. And therefore, today, you know, like we are discussing today, we would commemorate or we would remember the loss of those lives, particularly youth and students in the Tiananmen Square, you know, which is where the values of liberal democracies come to the fore. Even after the Holocaust, you know, while initially there was a certain amount of reluctance to acknowledge what happened in the Holocaust, today the history books in the liberal world clearly tell you it happened and they even analyze it. So the societies become more strong when they realize what mistakes are committed. Unfortunately, China does not this give option to its citizens, which is actually something that they need to introspect. So I don't think it may be an aspirational path, but it's not a great path.
Thank you very much, sir. Lies written in ink cannot hide facts written in blood. The horror of the killings at Tiananmen Square resonates both inside and outside of China. While memories of these events cannot be excised, they can be properly addressed by China. Thank you very much, sir, for taking time out to be with us today and for the note. Thank you.
Thank you.